Just imagine being diagnosed with breast cancer, truly one of the most overwhelming pieces of news you could ever be given. Now, on top of that, imagine you were only given partial information concerning your treatment options. And I don't mean just whether or not to remove the breast. I'm talking about so much information being left out that your future options, once you're cured of cancer, became limited. It's happening. Believe me, it's happening today, and it may happen to somebody that you love.
I'm Rebecca Larson. I am 33 years old and was initially diagnosed with breast cancer at age 30. The tumor size was the size of the palm of my hand, 10 centimeters by 6 centimeters by 2 centimeters. Diagnosis was DCIS, which is ductal carcinoma in situ, meaning that it was a stage 0 cancer. The only treatment they recommended for me was a modified radical mastectomy, which means that they took my entire breast, including the nipple. My surgeon at the time recommended no reconstruction, which meant I was left for 10 very long months with one tiny breast and no options. I had no further options other than prostheses to get me through. The emotional stress was unbelievable. I did not feel like a woman. I didn't look like a woman. I was scarred from the waist up. I felt mangled every day. I had to look at my sliced up body every day in the mirror. The psychological toll of that sent me into a tailspin. A severe depression, inability to leave the house. My sole focus was my daughter. And I felt she was the only person on the face of the earth who accepted me the way that I looked. I wish I had known about immediate reconstruction then. I would not have faced what I had to face during that 10 months. I would still have looked like a woman. I would still have felt like a woman. I would have been able to work. I would have been able to wear something besides a t-shirt that was two sizes too big and shorts. I wanted to feel sexy. I wanted to feel female. I was 30 years old. Many younger women face extremely aggressive cancers. They should also have aggressive treatment, but that does not mean that they must sacrifice what little vanity we're left with. It's hard enough to be bald and sick, but to do it with one breast is just cruel. After 10 months, I decided to have a prophylactic mastectomy on the left side with immediate reconstruction. Had I known at initial diagnosis what I know now, I would have opted for immediate reconstruction. The result on the left side is much prettier than that on the right. Second diagnosis was February of 2008, which meant I stopped reconstruction. I did chemotherapy, I did radiation, and a year of Herceptin. After that, I was officially done with treatment, and I could finish reconstruction. I had a silicone swap in April of this year, and am now almost completed with getting my tattoos in early July. I'm very excited about this. After 2.5 years of cancer diagnoses and treatment, I'm now almost finished.
Welcome to Plastic Surgery Talk. I'm Dr. Bill Adams, and today we're going to talk about questions that some breast cancer patients, maybe even someone you love, don't know to ask. With me is Dr. Lou Buckey, a plastic surgeon from Philadelphia and one of the country's leading experts on breast reconstruction surgery. And we also have with us Rebecca Larson. Rebecca has survived breast cancer twice, had a double mastectomy, and her reconstruction is almost finished. I've asked her to pose some questions that breast cancer patients should ask before surgery. Many of these are questions Rebecca wishes she would have asked before her own treatment. Lou, Rebecca, it's great to have you on the show.
Thanks, Bill.
Thank you.
So, Lou, you know, I saw this statistic recently that 70% of women with breast cancer miss out on forms of patient care simply because they don't know about them. How can we address this issue?
Well, it's a difficult problem, Bill. We just heard an incredible story from Rebecca that has been on a relatively unique journey, but the problem of not having complete information at the time of the original consultation, unfortunately, is more common than we like it to be. And it really boils down to an absence of education, not just education for the patients, but education for the physicians that are consulting with the patients. And I think ultimately it comes down to the fact that a lot of physicians don't know what the advances in breast reconstruction have led to in the ultimate result for patients, and therefore can't give a comprehensive consult in a fashion that would lead for patients to have the appropriate information.
I think we'll hear more about that from Rebecca later in the show. Rebecca, you've been obviously down a very difficult path. First, let's give everybody your good news.
Thank you. Yes, I have. And a few weeks ago, I was diagnosed as NED. That means no evidence of disease. I'm officially cancer-free.
That's fabulous. So one of the things we want you to do with us today is knowing what you know now, what questions would you have asked before you started all this? You know, hindsight's always 20/20, but what would you have asked now that you know what you know?
I didn't have immediate reconstruction, and I wish that I had. What I would like to know is who is a candidate for immediate reconstruction and who isn't?
Lou?
I think that's a great question. That answer has changed over the last decade, and I think, Rebecca, today almost everybody's a candidate for immediate reconstruction. The patients who are not candidates, I think, are people who emotionally or psychologically can't make a good decision, or their oncologic treatment, their cancer dictates that maybe they should wait. But those patients are becoming fewer among the wide spectrum of patients that present with a newly diagnosed breast cancer.
What are the three most important things a patient needs to know before reconstruction or about reconstruction?
Well, I think at the time of consultation, the patient who comes in typically is quite shocked at her diagnosis. And so it's a difficult time to make good decisions or gather all the information you need. So I try and simplify things a fair bit, and I think there are essentially three things you need to know. One, why have reconstruction? What are the aesthetic goals of reconstruction? What will you look like? The second thing is, what physically am I a candidate? What type of reconstruction am I a candidate to have? And then the third thing is, you need to know about recovery. You need to do some planning. So what kind of recovery will that reconstruction dictate? If we accomplish those three things during a consultation, I think that's enough, and you should be able to hear most of it, that you can make a good decision for yourself.
I wish I had known that beforehand. Where does a plastic surgeon fit in our treatment plan?
Yeah, again, it's the role of the plastic surgeon today has changed quite a bit from 10 years ago. I think that, like anything else in medicine, unless you can see where the end point is, it's hard to make a plan. And so the plastic surgeon needs to be integrated in your plan, just like the oncologist is integrated, the surgeon's integrated, whether or not you need radiation therapy. All those variables dictate what kind of reconstruction you can have, whether you should be an immediate reconstructive candidate, and ultimately what your result's going to look like. And so where we used to be the after portion of the process, I think it's very important that the team works together and have relationships so that everybody's on the same page.
You know, I think that the treatment of the breast cancer patient has evolved. Certainly the treatment of the cancer is the primary focus, but there's other things, and such as breast reconstruction. I think that you said that you just weren't aware that plastic surgery or breast reconstruction was feasible at the time of your initial surgery. Is that what I heard you say?
I was actually told to delay reconstruction because of the tumor size. I was later told, when I found a different surgeon, that that was unnecessary. And the almost year that I spent with that was completely unnecessary. I would like to have known then what I know now, and that's why I'm here.
And I guess you would have suggested that other people in your shoes now, you know, that they should ask the questions about other team members, whether it's reconstructive or other oncology participants in their care before they actually start it.
I would advise any person starting out to be extremely comfortable with their team beforehand. That was a hard lesson for me. I was not comfortable with my team at all. And I think that contributed to the necessary delay in treatment.